Right, so we have no class again next Monday or Wednesday. I'll be available between 8 and 9 o'clock those days for consulting about the project. I'm also available today. I know I have at least one group coming at about 2 o'clock today. And maybe if somebody else wants to come, say at 2:30 or 3, I can be here for them. And then Friday next week, we'll renew. I did forget to post homework on Wednesday for what you should do. I can basically just tell you what to do from now on besides the project. You should work on the other problems that are in Chapter 6 that are in the answer key. Section 6.1, 6.2, and 6.3. There are problems from each of those sections, and you should work on them as much as you feel like you need to understand the material for the final exam. Again, for the final exam, what I'll do is I'll take a sampling of old exam problems and modify the functions and or numbers a bit. And maybe the argument a little bit for a proof, maybe I'll make it a little different, but basically it'll be the same type of proof on the final exam. And then I'll put some problems, some new problems with new material, similar to problems in Chapter 6. And perhaps a geometric interpretation, maybe I'll give you a picture of a vector field, and you'll need to estimate a line integral, or at least if it's a positive, negative, or close to zero on that. Let's look once more at this example. Let's finally take it a little bit more rigorously as far as how you prove that the principal value of the integral that from minus infinity to infinity is pi using residues. So that's the function. It's got simple poles. At z equals plus or minus I. Simple pole means pole of order 1. Okay, that's synonymous. Simple pole means pole of order 1. So a pole at I and a pole at negative I. We have calculated the residues of this thing with at I, at least with Lorentz series. Let's use that other formula. Maybe we did do this calculation the other day. Let's do it again anyway. There's this formula involving limits. And when it's a simple pole, when it's a pole of order 1, it's a limit as z approaches the pole, in this case I, of z minus the pole times the function. That limit will exist. Z minus I is going to cancel with a z minus I in the bottom here if you factor. You'll get the limit of z goes to I of 1 over z plus I, and that would be 1 over 2i or negative 1 half I. So that's the residue. Therefore, the integral around any simple closed curve only in closing I in the counterclockwise or positive direction is going to be 2 pi I times this. This is capital gamma, the integral of f of z over capital gamma here by the residue theorem is going to be 2 pi I times this residue times negative 1 half I. The 2's cancel, I times negative I is positive 1. This simplifies to pi. But now how do you go back and prove that this implies that the integral, the principal value of the improper integral from minus infinity to infinity equals pi as well? Why does this imply that the principal value of the improper integral from minus infinity to infinity of 1 over 1 plus, I'll go ahead and call it z squared, but z is a real variable here, equal pi. We did see why the ordinary improper integral, not the principal value, but the ordinary improper integral, as a sum of two convergent improper integrals, from 0 to infinity and from minus infinity to 0, Both of those integrals converge to pi over 2, and therefore the sum converges to pi. The principal value idea is actually something different. Technically speaking, the principal value of this improper integral is defined to be a different kind of limit. It's a limit as, say, r goes to infinity of integrals of the following form. You sort of let both limits go off to their respective infinities at the same time. Now, if the ordinary improper integral without the PV symbol converges, and it does converge, and you can use the comparison test to prove that, or you can calculate it like we did, it turns out that the principal value of the improper integral also converges to the same thing. So why make a distinction? The distinction is improper integrals like this diverge, right? That obviously diverges. Thinking of it as being defined to be this, if these improper integrals converge or diverge. But these definitely diverge, right? Thinking in terms of area, the area under x is, you go from 0 to infinity, is infinity. And this integral is also infinity. These do not converge. These both diverge. And that technically means that this integral diverges as well. And I really shouldn't write an equal sign there, but we won't worry about it. However, the principal value of this improper integral does converge. If you write PV, integral from minus infinity to infinity of x dx, technically speaking, that's a different kind of limit. It's a limit of integrals like that, and those integrals are all zero. Right? The area under the curve when it's above the axis cancels out with the area above the curve when it's below the axis. The principal value of this improper integral converges to zero. But no, this improper integral diverges. It does not converge to zero. Because if it's going to converge, these both have to converge. And then this will converge to their sum. So it is a different idea, but in the context of improper integrals that do converge, then it's the same idea. Why is that relevant here? Come back to the complex plane here now. We've got the real axis in the complex plane. We're going to think about integrating over contours like this, where the upper part is a semicircle of radius r centered at the origin. Call this little gamma sub r, call this c sub r, and call the entire contour capital gamma sub r. For any fixed value of r, the integral around capital gamma sub r is the sum of the integral over little gamma sub r plus the integral over the semicircle of radius r centered at the origin. And as r goes to infinity, this part right here approaches the Cauchy principal value, because this is the same as the real integral from negative r to r of f of x dx, if z equals x, a real quantity. That's the same as this kind of integral. When your function is real valued along the real axis, which this is, right? This function gives you a real output when the input is real. The integral along a contour on the real axis is going to be the same as an ordinary integral. Calculus. This approaches the principal value of the improper integral. This thing right there by the residue is 2 pi I times the residue that we just found. We're still dealing with the same example here. We just found the residue to be, again, negative 1/2 I. This contour integral around the closed contour does equal pi. Therefore, this principal value will equal pi as well if this integral goes to 0 as r goes to infinity. For any fixed r, these two integrals do sum to pi. If this integral goes to 0 as r goes to infinity, that means the limit of this integral as r goes to infinity would have to equal pi. And that's what we define to be the principal value of the integral, the improper integral. How do you prove? You want to prove that this goes to 0 as r goes to infinity. How do you prove that? It's a little bit tricky, but not terribly bad. You can use the triangle inequality in a creative way. The function here still is 1 over z squared plus 1. There's kind of a funny way to use the triangle inequality, but it is valid. Think about the modulus of z squared. Imagine adding 1 to that and subtracting 1. I do get the same quantity. Now apply the triangle inequality to this expression. I guess I should maybe even rewrite it a little differently. Think of it as z squared plus 1 plus negative 1. Apply the triangle inequality to that. We've got the modulus of the sum of two things. It's going to be less than or equal to the modulus of the individual things added together. Modulus of a sum is less than or equal to the sum of the moduli. This has modulus 1. I could subtract 1 from both sides and then say this is true. And then I can take the reciprocal of both sides as long as I'm not dividing by 0. And say this is true as long also as this is positive over here on the right. As long as the modulus of z squared minus 1 is positive, I can do that. And if I'm on the semicircle of radius r centered at the origin, if z is a point on the semicircle of radius r centered at the origin, this is a constant there. This is going to be, well, if you want to be extra careful about it, you can write it that way. It's going to equal 1 over r squared minus 1 if z is on CR, the semicircle of radius r centered at the origin. And that's going to be helpful in proving that this integral goes to 0 as r goes to infinity, because recall that there's a theorem that says the modulus of the integral of a function over a contour, whether it's a closed contour or not, is less than or equal to if the function happens to be bounded by some number m on the contour. This integral is less than or equal to m times the length of the contour. This is the length of the contour. It doesn't have to be closed. So again, if the modulus of f of z is bounded by some number m over the contour, the modulus, this integral is less than or equal to m times the length of the contour itself. The length of the semicircle is pi times its radius. And therefore, I can now come back to this integral with this example here, with this particular function. I can say, in modulus, this integral is less than or equal to, at least if r is sufficiently big, don't take a small r, that thing, right? If r is too small, then this is negative. We need that to be true there. We need this to be positive. Times the length of the contour, which is pi times the radius. And this is a quantity that goes to zero as r goes to infinity. R is bigger than 1. And that essentially does it. Come back to this equation. This equation is true for any fixed r. The sum of these two integrals equals pi. Therefore, it's true as you let r go to infinity. As r goes to infinity, this integral approaches the principal value of the real integral there. This thing we've just seen now here approaches 0. Therefore, this integral, as r goes to infinity, must equal pi. Okay, so there's a little bit of a trick with the triangle inequality. You should be able to verify this in the way that I just did on the final exam. I probably wouldn't make it a proof problem, so you probably wouldn't have to write out sentences like I did not write out sentences, but you should be able to, if I give you some guidance perhaps, use the triangle inequality like I did to say this kind of thing would be true if r is bigger than 1 in this case, to help you say this is true if r is bigger than 1, and therefore as r goes to infinity, this is going to be have to be 0 as you let r go to infinity in the limit. This thing goes to 0 and therefore this equals pi as r goes to infinity. Meaning really the principal value of this improper integral equals pi. Okay? The book also gives an argument for why this kind of thing works in integrating any rational function in this kind of manner over contour like this and letting r go to infinity as long as the denominator has a degree 2 or more higher than the numerator. You can get the exact same kind of argument and ultimately say that this integral goes to 0 as r goes to infinity to say that the principal value, the improper integral, ends up equaling 2 pi I times the residue, or the sum of the residues if there's more than one pole for the function. Let's apply this to more examples then. We won't go through the argument again. But we will calculate residues some more. Let's modify the example. Let's go ahead and make this say, how about a, let's make it squared. Don't make it too hard here. 1 over z squared plus 1 squared, which can be factored like this. You've got poles of order 2. Now, not simple poles, at z equals plus or minus I. What are we after? We're after the same thing we were after before. We're after the principal value of the improper integral. We're going to use this kind of equation again. This integral is going to be 2 pi I times the sum of the residues. And this integral is going to go to 0 as r goes to infinity. So the principal value of the integral that we want really does equal 2 pi I times the sum of the residues. Now there's again only going to be one pole at I that's inside a contour like this. I'll do another example in a few minutes where there's a couple poles. What's the residue at I in this case? These limit formulas are seemingly unpleasant, but they are better than having to try to find the Laurent expansion. In the case with a pole of order 2, that's your m. Well, remember, in general, the formula is
take the limit as z goes to z0 of 1 over n minus 1 factorial times the n minus first derivative of z minus the pole to the nth power times f of z. This is this complicated formula involving limits for calculating residues in the general case. It's theorem 1 on page 310. It's not too hard to use when m is 1. It's a bit more of a pain when m is 2. Once m gets to 3 or 4 or 5, it gets to become a real pain. Right? Imagine if m were 5. Take a fourth derivative of z minus z0 to the fifth power times f of z, divide by 4 factorial, and then let z go to z0. It would be a real big pain. But we have m equal to 2 here, so in this case, it's not too bad. Still is probably better than calculating the Lorentz expansion, even when m is 5. M is 2 here, we get 1 over 1 factorial is 1, so I don't need to bother writing that. Got the first derivative of z minus I squared times f of z. Simplify the thing inside the parentheses here before you take the derivative. Z minus I squared times f of z is going to be z minus I squared times this thing. The z minus I squareds cancel, and you're left with 1 over z plus I quantity squared. We've got to take the derivative of that now. You can use the quotient rule, or if you prefer, this is simple enough you can avoid the quotient rule. It's the same as z plus I to the negative 2 power. So we get a limit as z approaches I of negative 2 times z plus I to the negative 3 power times 1 by the chain rule. You can find this limit by plugging in I. It's going to become negative 2 over 2i quantity cubed. 2 cubed is 8. 2 divided by 8 is 1/4. I cubed is what? I squared is negative 1, I cubed is negative I. But remember, dividing by negative I is the same as multiplying by I.
Right.
I can cancel the negative signs here, but then you ultimately end up with a negative sign in the end anywhere. It looks like it's negative 1/4 I in the end. Think about that. I could cancel those negative signs to start with and get 1 over 4i. But that's the same as negative 1/4 I. The residue is negative 1/4 I, so the integral... This integral in this, for this example, is going to be 2 pi I times negative 1/4 I. That's going to be pi 2 instead of pi. That's the value for the integral over this contour for any fixed value of r. And again, letting r go to infinity, the denominator does have a degree 2 or more greater than the numerator. This is going to go to 0. This approaches the principal value. This stays constant at pi over 2. Therefore, in the limit as r goes to infinity, the principal value of the improper integral is going to be pi over 2. Let's check that. Let's check it in Mathematica as an ordinary integral, an ordinary real integral. Is Mathematica programmed to calculate principal values instead of regular values? Well, it doesn't really matter in this example, because again, this is going to be a convergent improper integral. So
so it doesn't really matter whether it calculates principal values or non-principal values, based on the definition of the improper integral. I think it does the definition. I don't think it does principal values in general. We can test that, but hopefully the answer to this is pi over 2.
Maybe it is.
Yeah, let's test it quick here. Does it do a principal value or not? I can easily test that by seeing what it does to this example. It says it does not converge. Okay, if it were calculating the principal value, it would converge. Is it possible to do this integral without complex analysis? Theoretically, yes. Would it be difficult? You can always integrate rational functions theoretically without complex analysis. Gotta use partial fractions in general. Would this one be difficult or not? To tell you the truth, I'm not sure how difficult. We could get an idea for how difficult by seeing what the antiderivative looks like. It's not too bad, I guess. But it also allows you to see why, from the real approach, why the answer would be pi over 2. You have 1/2 arctangent of x instead of an arctangent of x. Yeah, pi over 2 instead of pi. This thing with the limits of integration and appropriate limits is going to go to 0. How about another example? Let's consider an example where inside the contour we've got more than one pole. How about 1 over z to the 4th plus 1 instead of z squared plus 1? Now we've got simple poles. Where? Oh, this is a good review of chapter 1. Simple poles where, at the 4th roots of negative 1, which are going to be on the unit circle, and thinking geometrically, here's negative 1 on the unit circle. It's got an argument of pi. And a modulus of 1, the principal 4th root is going to have a modulus of 1 and an argument pi divided by 4, 45 degrees, right, 4th root. And these 4 roots have to be separated by 90 degrees. They're going to be these 4 points. And you should be able to figure out what those are without much thought here. These are going to be 1 over square root of 2 plus 1 over square root of 2i, negative 1 over square root of 2 plus 1 over square root of 2i, negative 1 over square root of 2 minus 1 over square root of 2i, and plus 1 over square root of 2 minus 1 over square root of 2i. Or, in exponent in polar form, e to the I times pi over 4, e to the I times 3 pi over 4, e to the I times 5 pi over 4, and e to the I times 7 pi over 4 are the 4 fourth roots of negative 1, and those are going to be poles of this rational function, and they will have order 1. They will be simple. In integrating over contours, like that, then, when R is sufficiently large, bigger than 1, like before, you're going to have 2 poles inside there. You're going to need to calculate the sum of 2 residues before multiplying by 2 pi I to calculate this integral, and ultimately the limit of that. Let's calculate one of them by hand, and then we'll have Mathematica do the other one. What's the residue of this function at 1 over square root of 2 plus 1 over square root of 2i. Again, you could find it by finding the Laurent expansion about this number. It doesn't look very pleasant, though. This unpleasant formula with the limit is less unpleasant than trying to find the Laurent expansion. Does that make sense? Less unpleasant? Yeah, I guess that makes sense. M is 1 in this case, so I don't need to take a derivative, because there's always the m minus first derivative. Z minus the pole to the first power times the function. Again, simplify before trying to calculate the limit. How does this simplify? It's a bit of a pain, but still worth being able to do. Actually, it might be nice to factor this as a difference of two squares. That might be nice. This thing is the same as z squared squared minus I squared. It's a difference of two squares. It can be factored as z squared minus I times z squared plus I. And each of those is a difference of two squares as well. Though the thing that squares to I is more complicated. I could have written this from the start based on the knowledge of where the poles are. I could have written this from the start as z minus, in parentheses, 1 over square root of 2 plus 1 over square root of 2i times z minus, or well, let's go ahead and write it as plus 1 over square root of 2 plus 1 over square root of 2i, which is the same thing as minus negative 1 over square root of 2 minus 1 over square root of 2i. Next one, and the last one we could write like this. So, again, you could write that out, those four terms, just by looking at this picture, by realizing the four roots of z of negative 1 are at those four points. Didn't have to do this. So when we multiply that by z minus this thing, we get cancellation of one factor. This cancels with this one factor. Technically, I could multiply out these two things together and get a quadratic with real coefficients, because this and this are complex conjugates of each other. Not sure if that's worth doing. Let's just go ahead and let z go to z0 right now. Take this limit. With what's left, you're not dividing by zero. You get a continuous function at this point. You can evaluate the limit, but just by substitution. Substitute that number in for z here, here, and here, and make it the denominator where the numerator is 1. Numerator is 1 here. So the answer for this residue is going to be, in unsimplified form, 1 over, well, again, 1
over square root of 2 plus 1 over square root of 2i here, not here. Could we cancel that one? You're going to get 1 over square root of 2 plus 1 over square root of 2 is square root of 2. It's 2 over square root of 2, which is square root of 2. So we get a square root of 2. Plug it in here. Again, I'm plugging in this number here. The real parts are going to cancel, the 1 over square root of 2. And the imaginary part, you get plus 1 over square root of 2i plus another 1 over square root of 2i. 2 minus is making a plus. So we get square root of 2i. This is not too bad. Plug it in here, the imaginary parts cancel because of the minus sign there. And you're left with the real part being square root of 2 again. So it looks like we've got 1 over 2 root 2i, or negative I over 2 root 2. You could also rationalize the denominator if you want. You could also write this as negative root 2i over 4. Is this right? Let's check it with residue. Syntax is residue of the function, comma, in a list, put the variable name, and then put the location of the pole. Let's see if we got the right answer. So it looks like we made a mistake somewhere. Anybody happen to see my mistake?
Yeah. What happened to the imaginary part when you plugged it in on the first?
When I plugged it into this one?
Part.
Okay, that's my mistake.
Yeah.
Thanks. Should have gotten that. This part simplifies to 2i. I can bring the 2i through and get 1 over 2 root 2i minus 2 root 2. Okay. I multiply 2i times this and this. And if I multiply the top and the bottom by the complex conjugate of this, on the top it's going to give me this, and on the bottom it's going to give me the square of the modulus of this. 2 root 2 squared is going to be 8. Again, 2 root 2 squared is going to be 8. The 2 cancels with the 16. I can write this as negative root 2 minus root 2i over 8. Is that the same thing here? I think it is. Mathematica's answer. I can bring the root 2 up into these denominators like this. And then I could rationalize the denominators. I can multiply the top and the bottom by root 2. It is the same thing. That's the residue. What about the integral? Well, I gotta find the other residue. Because in this contour, again, that I erased, there are gonna be two poles now. When r is bigger than one, what's the residue at the other pole? Is that mathematically calculated? The other pole is this one. Right, think about it geometrically, two poles that are have a positive imaginary part, so this stays a plus, The real parts are opposites.
It's these two points here.
So we get that. Is that the opposite of the other one? It looks like it does it. No, it's not, excuse me. The minus sign on the top applies to both terms on top. So the sum of these residues is non-zero. I'm very glad that the sum of these is non-zero. I was worried there. The sum of these residues, let me just type it like this. Is that, and 2 pi I times that expression will be the answer for the integral. Pi over root 2. That'll be the integral around such a contour. Again, letting r go to infinity. The integral over the bottom piece approaches the principal value of the integral, of the real integral. The integral over the semicircle approaches 0. The solitude always equals pi over root 2. Therefore, in the limit as r goes to infinity, the principal value should be pi over root 2. Let's see if that's the case now. Should be pi over root 2, and it is. How bad would it be to do by hand without complex analysis? I'm sure this one would be more of a pain. Yikes. Could I do it? I think I could. The method, I'm not going to take the time to actually do it. But the method would involve trying to factor the bottom, not in terms of complex numbers, but as the product of two quadratics. You can use complex numbers to help you figure out what the quadratics are. One of them could be found by multiplying these two things. And the other quadratic could be found by multiplying those two things. Let me try the first case just to see what it is. Multiply this out. These are complex conjugates of each other. When you multiply this out, you're going to get something with real coefficients. You're going to get x squared, be careful here, minus 1/2 minus 1 over square root 2i times x minus 1/2, oh, 1 over root 2, excuse me, plus 1 over root 2i times x plus the product of these things. Forgetting my words, sorry about that. The imaginary parts cancel here and here. Right? Where is it? Yeah, this is a plus here because of two minuses. Minus a plus, the imaginary parts cancel. The real part here is minus this times x and minus this times x minus root 2x. And then this thing's going to be a real number. It's going to be 1/2 plus 1/2. This is going to be 1 here when you multiply this up. So one of the quadratics in the bottom is this. And it's got a square root of 2 in it. So it's not super pleasant. And then once you've done that, then you use partial fractions. You try to write 1 over x to the 4th plus 1 as some linear function divided by this thing here that I just found, plus some other linear function over the corresponding thing I'd get if I multiply these two things and some other quadratic. And you have to solve for A, B, C, and D. And even once you solve for A, B, C, and D, it would not be very pleasant still. You'd have to do some tricky algebra there, I think, as well, because a simple substitution would not necessarily allow you to integrate this. It would still be tricky from that point. I'd much rather do this one with complex analysis, actually, even though the arithmetic I did just 10 minutes ago was kind of tricky as well. With the time we have remaining, let's do more examples, but with the computer this time, completely. And we might have to do some approximations here in what I'm about to do. Take your arbitrary looking rational function with real coefficients here, by the way. We do want this to be real valued when z is real. And make the denominator have a degree two or more greater than the degree of the numerator. So I want, since the numerator has degree 3, I want the denominator to have degree 5 or 6 or 7. I'll go with 5. These can't be arbitrary, though. I do want the denominator to have complex roots. And I want them to be complex conjugates paired with each other so that I get a real polynomial. So I'm going to take it to be degrees 6. Let's make the roots of the denominator, say, z minus... z plus 2i, z minus 1 plus I times z minus 1 minus I, complex conjugate pairs here, z minus negative, how about 2 plus 3i times z minus 2 minus 3i. By making those complex conjugate pairs like I did, that does guarantee that the bottom does expand into having real coefficients, so it will be real value when z is real. I guess since I did make the poles something easily identifiable, we should be able to calculate the residue technically by hand and without approximations. That would be a big pain. Theoretically, you should be able to do it. What's the residue at 2i? That's one of the poles. Three poles that are going to be above the horizontal axis are going to be at 2i. At 1 plus i. And at 2 plus 3i. My syntax is bad here, just a second. I'm putting in a list so I just see all three answers at once. Those are the residues. I got to add those up and divide by, or multiply by 2 pi i. 2 pi i times the sum of these things. This thing plus this thing plus this thing should be the value of the contour integral over one of these semicircles, closed semicircles, of sufficiently large radius to include all three poles. Equal to that. That also should be the value of the improper integral, principal value, and it would be a convergent improper integral, so the principal value would be the same as the regular value of the improper integral. Is it? Oh boy. Well, I guess f of z is already plugged in here, f of x. Oh boy, I'm feeling nervous. Is this going to be right? Yay! Right, the thrill of math? It worked. Of course, it's the bane of math when it doesn't work, right? Like, what went wrong? It worked. By the way, before you go, I do have to share with you something I was thrilled by the other day. I was exploring and wondered, I was doing a few different things, and one search that I did was a number of grains of sand versus number of stars in the universe. Which is greater? And it was the number of stars in the universe. They do a universe that's greater than the number of grains of sand. They estimated somewhere in here. Somebody estimated these numbers. I thought they were right in here. Population of stars. The 70,000 million 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 stars. What would that be? Something around 10 to the 21st or something? And the number of grains of sand was on the order of 10 to the 18th. But both of those numbers are less than the number of water molecules in 10 drops of water. Take 10 drops of water, and there's more water molecules in there than the number of stars in the universe. So that was something that I was in awe of. I was also doing some exploring about, like, what's the biggest star in the universe, at least that we found. And there was one, I forgot the name, so that if you put the center of the star at the center of the sun, it would go out past the orbit of Jupiter. And if you know anything about distances in space, that is amazing. It's like, I don't know, a billion times bigger than the sun. I don't know if it's in radius or in volume, but it was just tremendously huge. Anyway, so no class next Monday and Wednesday. We'll see you next Friday for review.